Hamelin towns in Brunswick, by famous Hanover City, the river Weser, deep and wide, washes its wall on the southern side. A pleasanter spot you never spied. But when begins my duty, almost 500 years ago, to see the townsfolk suffer so from vermin was a pity. Rats, they fought the dogs and killed the cats, and bit the babies in the cradles and let the cheeses out of the vats, and licked the soup in the cook's own ladles, split open the kegs of salted sprats, made nests inside men's Sunday hats, and even spoiled the women's chats by drowning their speaking with shrieking and squeaking in 50 different shouts and flats. In a body to the town hall came flocking. 'Tis clear, cried they, our mayor's a noddy, and as for our corporation, shocking to think we buy gowns lined with ermine for dolts that don't or won't determine what's left to rid us of our vermin. You hope, because you're old and obese, to find in the furry civic robe ease? Rouse up, sirs, give your brains a racking to find the remedy worth lacking, for sure as fate will send you packing. At this, the mayor and corporation quaked with mighty consternation. An hour they sat in council. At length the mayor broke silence.
For a guilder, I'd buy ermine gown, sir. I wish I were a mile hence. It's easy to bid one rack one's brain. I'm sure my poor head aches again. I've scratched it so, and all in vain. Oh, but a trap, a trap, a trap!
Just as he said this, what should hap at the chamber door but a gentle tap?
Bless us, what's that? Only a scraping of shoes on the mat. Anything like the sound of a rat makes my heart go pitter-pat. Come in!
The mayor cried, looking bigger. And in did come the strangest figure. His queer long coat and heels head was half of yellow and half of red. And he himself was tall and thin, with sharp blue eyes, each like a pin. And like his hair, yet swarthy skin, no tuft on cheek nor beard on chin, but lips where smiles went out and in. There was no guessing his kith and kin, and nobody could enough admire the tall man and his quaint attire. Quoth one, it says my great-grandsire, starting up at the trump of doomstone, had walked this way from his painted tombstone. Advanced to the council table.
Please, your honors, I'm able, by means of a secret charm, to draw all creatures living beneath the sun, that creep or swim or fly or run after me, so as you never saw. And I chiefly use my charm on creatures that do people harm. The mole and toad and newt and viper, and people call me the Pied Piper. Yet, poor piper as I am, last June, from his huge swarm of gnats. I eased in Asia the nizam of a monstrous brood of vampire bats. And as for what your brain bewilders, if I can rid your town of rats, will you give me 10,000 guilders? If I can rid your town of rats, will you give me 1,000 guilders?
Ricky Mouse, Ricky Mouse, Ricky Mouse, Ricky Mouse, Ricky Mouse.
One, 50,000 was the exclamation of the astonished mayor and corporation. Into the street the piper went, smiling at first a little smile, as if he knew what magic slept in his quiet pipe the while. Then, like a musical adept, to blow the pipe his lips he wrinkled, and green and blue his sharp eyes twinkled, like a candle flame where salt is sprinkled. And ere three small shrill notes the pipe uttered, you heard as if an army muttered. And the muttering grew to a grumbling, and the grumbling grew to a mighty rumbling, and out of the houses the rats came tumbling. Great rats, small rats, lean rats, brawny rats, brown rats, black rats, grey rats, tawny rats, grave old plodders, gay young friskers, fathers, mothers, uncle cousins, cocking tails and pricking whiskers. families by tens and dozens, brothers, sisters, husbands, wives. Follow the piper for their lives. From street to street the piper sounding, and step by step they followed dancing, until they came to the river Weser, wherein all plunged and perished. The steeple. Go, cried the mayor, and get long poles. Poke out the nests and block up the holes. Consult with carpenters and builders, and leave in our town not even a trace of the rats. When suddenly up the face of the piper perked in the marketplace.
If you please, my 1,000 guilders. If you please, my 1,000 guilders.
A 1,000? Guilders? The mayor looked blue, so did the corporation too. The council dealers made rare havoc with claret, moselle, bandit, and pop, and half the money would replenish their cellar's biggest butt with Rhenish. To pay this sum to a wandering fellow with a gypsy coat of red and yellow?
Beside, our business was done at the river's. We saw with our eyes the vermin sink, and what's dead can't come to life, I think. So friend, we're not the folks to shrink from the duty of giving you something to drink, and a matter of money to put in your poke. But as for the gilder that we spoke of, them, as you very well know, was a joke. Beside, our losses have made us thrifty. 1,000 guilders, come take pity.
The piper's face fell, and he cried,
"Not rightly, I can't wait. Beside, I promised to visit my dinner-time bandit and accept the bribe of the headquarters cottage. All he's rich in for having left in the caliph's kitchen of a nest of scorpions, no survivors. With him I prove no bargain driver. With you, don't think I'll make
being worse treated than a cook, insulted by a lazy ribald. I do pipe and best your piebald. You threaten us, fellow, to your worst. Blow your pipe there till you
stepped into the street, and to his lips laid his long pipe of smooth straight cane. And ere he blew three notes, such sweet notes as yet musician's cunning never gave the enraptured air, there was a rustling that seemed like a bustling of merry crowds, jostling, a pinching, a hustling. Small feet were pattering, wooden shoes clattering, little hands clapping and little fans clattering, like flowers in a farmyard where barley is scattering. Out came children running, all the little boys and girls with flaxen curls and sparkling eyes and teeth like pearls. Tripping and skipping ran merrily after the wonderful music and shouting and laughter. To the children merrily skipping by, could only follow with the eye this joyous crowd at the partner's back. But now the mayor was on the rack, and the wretched council's bosom beat as the piper turned from the high street to where the bays rolled its waters right in the way of their sons and daughters. However, he turned from south to west, and the Troubleberg hill he stepped abreast, and after him the children pressed. The joy in every breast. Thank you. Alas for Hamelin, the mayor sent east, west, north, and south to offer the piper by word of mouth wherever it was men's lot to find him. Silver and gold to his heart's content, if he'd only return the way he went and bring the children behind him.
Thank you.
ritum quasi ci di.
When they saw it was a lost endeavor, and piper and dancers were gone forever, they made a decree that lawyers never should think their records dated duly, if after the day of the month and year, these words did not as well appear. And so long after what happened here, on the 22nd of July, 1376, and the better in memory to fix, the place of the children's last retreat shall be called the Pied Piper's Street, where anyone playing on pipe or tabor was sure for the future to lose his labor. Nor suffered they in hostelry or tavern to shock with mirth the street so solemn, but opposite the place of the cavern they wrote the story on a column, and on the great church window painted the same to make the world acquainted how their children were stolen away. And there it stands to this very day. Pipers out of scores with all men, especially pipers, whether they pipe us free from rats or from mice, if we promise them aught, let us keep our promise.